COVID-19 has brought an unusual time upon us, forcing us all to adapt suddenly to life with lockdowns, quarantining, and social distancing. Everyone is eager to get back to normal life. But what does it mean for this to all be over? People yearn for life after COVID-19, but it's not a matter of flipping a switch and going back to life just as it was pre-shutdown. As long as the virus persists, even at a lower level, the norms of our everyday lives will be different than before we ever heard of SARS-CoV-2. Physical distancing and frequent hand washing will probably need to be in place even after lockdowns have been lifted. Our best hope is to safely, gradually regain a bit of life as we knew it. Strides towards normalcy hinge on decreasing infection rates. The problem is, there's a huge pool of people who are susceptible to infection. Right now, almost everyone is in that pool. R-naught describes the contagiousness of an infectious disease. It describes the average number of people that will become infected stemming from one initial infection. Right now, experts estimate that the R-naught of SARS-CoV-2 is between 2.2 and 2.7. This means that on average, for every one person that's infected, at least two other people will get infected, and so on. The effective reproduction number is a different number, which describes the observed spread of a virus in the community. It's similar to R-naught, except that it also takes into account the effects of control measures and public health interventions that have been put in place in that community. Safely ending lockdowns and loosening control measures depends on our ability to control the spread of the virus. And to do that, we need to shrink the pool so that RF is less than 1. Pushing RF down to less than 1 is a long-term goal that depends on uncertain factors. One factor is natural immunity. We still don't know if people who are infected and recover are immune to getting the virus again. If they are, this population of people leave the susceptible pool and the pool shrinks. But if they still can become infected again after recovering, they remain in this pool and it doesn't get any smaller. Another factor is how long it will take until a vaccine is developed, tested, and distributed. Vaccines trick the immune system into thinking it's infected with a specific virus, just enough so that the body is well prepared with the right antibodies. The vaccine lets your immune system know what to expect so it'll be prepared to fend off the virus if you are exposed, providing you immunity. Once a vaccine can provide sufficient immunity for enough of the population, the susceptibility pool will shrink. So until we can accomplish shrinking the pool of people who are susceptible, we can better control the spread by monitoring who is infected with surveillance testing. Surveillance testing relies on making smart assumptions about who is most likely to be infected, and then being able to actually test those people so we can monitor cases. This way, we can detect new cases when they occur and focus on preventing those cases from spreading by enforcing self-isolation and tracing back who those people may have come in contact with. This is called contact tracing. Only once we have a robust surveillance testing system can we really afford to relax social distancing measures, because until we can accurately determine who is spreading the disease, we have to assume everyone is. Especially since people who don't show symptoms can still spread the virus. A problem we've been facing is the scalability and availability of testing. One of these limitations has been based on not having the infrastructure to administer these tests. Testing is done with nasopharyngeal swabs and has to be administered by healthcare workers to be done properly. This means healthcare workers need protective equipment, like masks and gloves, just to perform these tests. But given the shortage of this equipment and the shortage of NP swabs themselves, one innovative solution recently proposed is to use saliva instead of nasal swabs for testing. Saliva tests seem to have greater accuracy and don't need to be administered by healthcare workers, so testing won't be restricted by the limited PPE resources. This solution is an example of envisioning a scalable and more accurate testing framework. Of course, researchers are also actively working towards a vaccine. Vaccination can lead to herd immunity, which means if enough people are vaccinated, it'll make it much harder for the disease to spread. Enough people will be immune that the virus spread will slow down until it almost dies out. Most people think that once we have a vaccine developed, we'll be all set. But in reality, public health officials will be facing a daunting new set of challenges, even with the vaccine developed. Like figuring out how to manufacture enough of them, who pays for them, and who should get vaccinated first. Historically, we've seen pandemics occur in multiple waves. First, a peak of cases, which then slows down, and then is followed by another peak of cases. This can happen in cases when we don't have natural lasting immunity against a pathogen and when the disease has not yet been eliminated. In these cases, the disease may reemerge when control measures are relaxed. It makes sense because the measures and restrictions that are keeping us at home and apart have been making it much harder for the virus to spread. But this doesn't mean that the virus is going to go away and we can lift these measures. Think about it this way. Just because you found an umbrella to stand under doesn't mean that the rain has stopped. If we lift these measures too soon, we're bound to see a resurgence of cases as another outbreak, aka a second wave. Some experts also think that spread of SARS-CoV-2 may shift and follow a yearly recurring pattern with higher outbreaks seasonally. So it's possible COVID-19 may shift from pandemic to endemic. Currently, COVID-19 is declared a pandemic, which means there's a large outbreak of cases in a short amount of time. Becoming endemic would mean that the disease is maintained at a low level throughout the year and causes outbreaks seasonally every year. In fact, other types of coronaviruses are endemic and often responsible for the common cold. It's also the pattern we see with other respiratory viral illnesses like flu. In staying home and practicing social distancing, you're playing a critical role in making it harder for the virus to spread. In fact, what makes SARS-CoV-2 especially hard to control is that it depends on human behavior. For example, the control of the West Nile virus, a mosquito-borne disease, is attributed to the control of human contact with mosquitoes. Logically, the way to control outbreaks is by controlling and reducing human contact with mosquitoes. But with a respiratory virus like COVID-19, we have to reduce human contact with other humans to control the spread. Turns out, controlling human activity is much harder to do than controlling mosquitoes. Humans can be influenced by economic, ideological, and political pressures in ways that mosquitoes are not. But so much in what the future holds is dependent on human behavior. Everyone's antsy to get back to their normal lives, but rushing into it could undo all the efforts of lockdowns and social distancing we've done so far. This has to be a unified effort, because even if just some people and places in one area relax vigilance too soon, it could easily increase spread all over the country. In fact, studies have shown that the cases of COVID-19 in Connecticut are more connected with cases in Washington State than to cases in Wuhan or Italy. This suggests the most severe spread is happening within the US, not coming in from outside the borders. It's not a foreign virus, so we must be vigilant with controlling the spread within the country. Relaxing protective measures too soon in one part of the country will endanger the rest of the country. A longer-term goal we need to address is to have better outbreak preparedness and better systems in place for surveillance testing for new diseases and outbreaks in the future. That future isn't so distant, so this isn't something that can be put on the back burner. New infectious diseases and zoonotic transmission of diseases will arise more frequently. Zoonotic transmission is transmission that happens from animals to people. This is likely increasing because of a reduction of natural habitats for animals, climate change, and our explosive human population growth. But if we develop infrastructures before the next disease hits, we can be better prepared and hopefully won't give it the chance to be as devastating as we find COVID-19 now is.